Thank you, Dr. Taneja. I welcome all of you to this a little chilly morning in this room. Outside it's sunny, I know. Anyway, we'll start the IC. We have a keynote address by a very renowned personality, Dr. Irina Ipanova. She's honored Doctor of the Russian Federation, Deputy Director for Science at the S. Fyodorov Eye Microsurgery State Institution, St. Petersburg Branch. She has done a PhD in eye diseases and immunology, also Doctor Science in Eye Diseases and Full Professor in Eye Diseases. Scope of scientific and clinical interest is eye inflammatory diseases, retinal pathology, laser ophthalmic surgery, and ocular oncology. Professor Panova is the author of more than 450 scientific articles, 13 educational and methodological works, and 5 patents. She is a co-editor of 4 books in different fields of ophthalmology and chapters in the Manual of Clinical Ophthalmology. Under the supervision of Professor Panova, 3 doctoral and 27 PhD theses have been defended. Professor Panova is also a board member of the Russian Society of Ophthalmologists and editorial board member of the journal The Russian Annals of Ophthalmology. She is an expert of Council's red eye, retinal and optic nerve diseases, and eye oncology. May I please welcome and invite Dr. Panova to deliver her keynote address on eyelid cancer surgery. Ma'am, please.
Thanks a lot for your invitation. Dear colleagues and friends, I'm very pleased to be here today and to present the topic of my professional interest. Today I will speak about eyelid cancer surgery, and I think that this presentation just for young ophthalmologists. We know that the malignant eyelid skin tumors is a very serious problem nowadays. I calculated that despite the skin area of eyelid is very small, but the malignant eyelid skin tumors has a high proportion among malignant tumors of the eye and about 5% of all skin tumors. In our Eye Fyodorov's clinic, we operated annually more than 500 patients with this pathology. For the treatment, we use different method. It will be radical and palliative. When we decide which method to choose, we follow the next selection criteria like this, such as clinical and morphological features of tumor, localization, primary tumor site, patient age, and physical general condition. You can see on this pie chart that in my practice I prefer surgery for the treatment of this pathology. And what is necessary for successful surgical treatment of malignant eyelid skin tumors? The first doctor should know the frequency and clinical symptoms of this pathology. The doctor should observe the principles of removing a tumor. And the doctor should practice methods of reconstructive and plastic surgery. In my practice, basal cell carcinoma prevails among other types of skin tumors. Radical surgery is a basic principle in treatment. It's very important. The main principle of radical surgery are total tumor removal, the operation just under the microscope, careful removal of tumor in single block within healthy tissue, and marking. And careful hemostasis is very important part of operation. And what about boundaries? The boundaries of the skin excision are different. If we operated basal cell carcinoma, it will be from 3 to 5 millimeters. In the case of squamous cell carcinoma or melanoma skin cancer, it's about 10 millimeters. One-stage combinated reconstructive and plastic surgery is important part in patient rehabilitation. During the reconstructive and reconstruction, which should include restoring outer and inner lining, and we need to restore anatomic integrity, eyelid function, and removal of cosmetic defects. We have a lot of different variants of eyelid reconstruction after surgical treatment malignant skin tumors. You can see on this part the different variants in my practice. If we have a small tumor or if we have big tumor and good skin mobility, we can use in local tissue, for example, direct suturing. If we need use in flap, we can follow the main principle for using flap. It's obviously careful manipulation and what to choose skin from the forehead to cheeks. We show pay attention to the skin condition and skin mobility and remember about Langer's line. On my opinion, the rotation of the flap will be from 60 to 90 degrees if we use a transposition flap. And in my practice, I often use skin grafts. After this operation, we have a good aesthetic results, like in this patient after 3 months. Very good aesthetic results we have after using advancement flap. And transposition sleeping flap also good for lower eyelid. And often I use a transposition flap taken from forehead because this flap has a good vascularization and can cover big defect and also good after radiation. And for the inner lining reconstruction, we have a lot of different variants also. And in my practice, I prefer moved conjunctiva and sliding flap. And if I have a big defect of lower eyelid, I use Hughes operation or modified Hughes operation. But in old patient, I prefer using transposition skin flap and conjunctiva. We have a good results, anatomical functional result, and in some cases we got aesthetic results. In summary, I would like to speak that in some patients we need a combinated treatment which includes preoperative radiotherapy and combinated flap of various modification. And in this case, with patient with basal cell carcinoma, we have a good results after combinated treatment. In conclusion, I would like to say that, in my opinion, surgical treatment of malignant tumors of eyelid skin is preferred in view on ensuring a radical treatment, obtaining histopathological confirmation of the diagnosis, and low frequency of tumor recurrence. And the variety of reconstruction method gives us an opportunity to achieve a good functional and anatomical result. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for the invitation very much.
Thank you, Dr. Inova, for a very comprehensive talk. I think we are running a little short of time, so we'll just hurry up and start with our IC. And our topics for today, the oculoplasty tutorial step-by-step approach. The first topic is going to be covered by Senior Professor Dr. A.K. Khurana on ptosis unfolded, areas of importance, then followed by surgical correction of entropion, avoid skin scar, Dr. Neelam, and again a surgical correction of entropion and innovative technique by Dr. Bhavna Khurana. Cicatricial ectropion, scar remodeling and definitive management by myself, and lid retraction managing the staring eye by Dr. Rachna Meel. I would request the speakers to kindly stick to the time also and introduce themselves while they begin this. So I request Dr. Khurana, do you want to sit over here? The co-instructors, I would request Dr. Neelam Pushkar, ma'am. She's from RP Center, Ames. Renowned oculoplastic surgeon, Dr. Rachna Meel, also from Dr. RP Center, Dr. Bhavna Khurana, kindly come up. She's looking after Khurana Eye Center in Rohtak. And the first talk by a renowned professor and a mentor and a teacher to so many of us, respected Dr. A.K. Khurana, sir. So please kindly come and begin your talk.
Good morning, everyone. So I just mentioned few points about the areas of importance in ptosis management. So as we all know, ptosis is the drooping of the upper eyelid, and the upper eyelid covers more than normal 2 millimeters when we label it. So it may be associated with the brow elevation due to frontalis overaction, and chin up posture may be there in patients with bilateral ptosis. The areas of importance in diagnosis, first of all, we need to know whether it is a true ptosis or is a pseudotosis due to lack of support or other causes. Then is it a contralateral eyelid retraction, and whether it's, if it is true ptosis, whether it is congenital or acquired. So if it is congenital ptosis, we should know is a simple one or associated with the spherectus weakness, or it's case of blepharophimosis syndrome, or we are dealing with Marcus Gunn jaw winking ptosis. If it is acquired, we should try to find out whether it is the, what is the etiological cause. Is it epineurotic, myogenic, neurogenic, mechanical, or traumatic, so that it will help you in the further management. So in clinical workup of each case, we should measure, these measurements should be done. The palpebral fissure height, marginal reflex distances 1, 2, and 3, marginal crease distance, marginal limbal distance, and levator action. So then we can grade the ptosis into mild, moderate, severe. Then grading of the levator function is also important. It can be done with the help of Burke's method. We measure the amount of excursion, and maybe normal, good, fair, or poor, depending upon the amount of excursion. Then looking for belt phenomena is extremely important, because if the poor belt phenomena, invariably we may have to do the undercorrection to avoid exposure keratitis. In congenital ptosis, almost always we need surgery. So it's, what is, should be the timing of surgery? In mild to moderate ptosis, we can wait up to more than 3 years of age, so that when you can have a proper assessment. However, in severe ptosis, we need to tackle earliest to prevent the amblyopia. And if it is associated with the strabismus, that should be tackled early, because strabismus surgery will also affect the level of the eyelids. Then in acquired ptosis, we may have to opt non-surgical versus surgical measures depending upon the cause of the acquired ptosis. So when we are dealing with the congenital ptosis, the choice of surgery will depend upon the severity of ptosis, amount of levator action, and this, whether it is simple ptosis or associated with other anomalies. So it is always important to quantify and classify ptosis in two different settings. Always measure the levator function in two different settings, because first time you may not be at the exact position. Then depending upon whether ptosis is mild, moderate, severe, and how much is the levator action, we can choose the surgery out, whether fascinal servette or levator plication or levator resection or sling surgery, depending upon. So first surgery, fascinal servette, it can be done when the ptosis is mild and the levator action is good. So however, this technique was associated with the peaking of the lid arch in many cases, and even corneal abrasions or suture keratopathy. So Bitharia et al. Modified this technique, which avoids crushing of the tissue, avoids central peaking, and also avoids suture keratopathy. So we will be discussing its steps in brief. So the upper lid is averted, and then four zero traction sutures are placed at the superior border of the tarsus. Another set of 4-0 stay sutures is passed through the folded lid about 4 millimeters above the sphere axis. These act as stay sutures. Then the required amount of the tarsal section is marked over the averted tarsal, staying parallel to the lid margin. Full thickness excision should be performed along the entire extent. Then a 6-0 cataract suture may be passed through the skin of the medial end, and then needle is brought inside to suture the conjunctiva in a continuous fashion. And in the end, the suture is finally exteriorized on the skin side at the lateral end. So the final note is on the skin side. So these are few examples treated by fascinal servette surgery, mild ptosis. Then levator resection. So the amount of resection we can have just this table, which can give you a rough idea, not exactly, depending upon the amount of ptosis, the amount of eyelid excursion. We can divide into mild, moderate, or severe, or minimum or maximum resections. Best is that we should adjust the lid margin at the table. So usually when this LPS function is poor, we should aim at superior limbus. If it is fair, then 2 millimeter below the limbus, and good LPS 3 to 5 millimeter below the limbus, because the lid will elevate in these cases. Then in the skin approach, the unilateral ptosis, we first of all you mark this skin crease line where the incision to be given. So in unilateral cases, we have to maintain symmetry with the other eye. However, in bilateral cases, we can have 6 to 7 millimeters in males and about 8 to 9 millimeters in females. And then skin incision is given at this point. Then orbicularis is separated to expose the orbital septum, and then tarsal plate is exposed inferiorly. So then we should, after identify the septum, orbital septum should be incised to expose the pre-epineuratic fat pad and the liver trap endosis. So vitna ligament should be visualized on detecting the overlying pad of the fat as whitish facial condensation running across junction of the muscular and the epineuritic part of the levator. Then we just revert it, and conjunctiva is lifted away from the levator epineurosis by a subconjunctival injection of the xylocaine with atylene. Then we can either use the ptosis clamp, or better is the 4-0 silk traction suture placed through the levator epineurosis at its insertion. The levator is then disinserted from the tarsal plate and separated from the underlying Muller's conjunctiva complex by blunt dissection. Then medial and lateral horns should be cut meticulously. 3 cardinal sutures pass from the tarsus through the levator muscle. Sutures are tightened with temporary knots, and final permanent knots are tied after seeing the lid margin where we want to keep as in comparison to the limbus. The redundant stump of the epineurosis is then excised. The lid crease is formed with 3 interrupted 6-0 vicryl sutures passed through the orbicularis muscle, including the levator stump. Skin should be closed with 6-0 or proline sutures. Then, what are the special areas of importance? In cutting of the LPS zone, be careful about the vitna ligament, medially superior oblique tendon, and laterally the lacrimal gland. While doing suture placement, always avoid passing suture through the orbital septum. Tarsal suture 2 to 3 millimeter below the superior tarsal border, and create a good eyelid crease by taking appropriate bites from the LPS. So these are the examples of the LPS resection. Then this sling operation, this indicated the bilateral moderate to severe ptosis with very poor LPS action. Unilaterally, in rare situations, for example, following levator excision or Marcus gun phenomena, severe unilateral ptosis with poor levator function, though rare. We can use either the autologous fascia lata, or most commonly, or temporalis fascia. Then synthetic materials used are either 3-0 ethibone suture, 3-0 proline, or nowadays most of the people are using silicone rods, which are readily available. So how you can harvest the fascia lata? Its advantage is that it virtually there is no recurrence, and only few granulomas are formed. Disadvantage is that of the synthetic material, if we use, the recurrence is infection and growth. So we can either use the Fox pentagon technique or the Crawford double triangle scene, as shown in the figure. We should give the incisions are marked, and then with the help of the eyelid incision and eyebrow incision and the forehead incision, they are made, and then this rod or suture, whatever you want to use, it is passed, as shown in these figures. And in the end, we should tighten them. And then wound can be closed with the help of 6-0 interrupted prolines, and frost suture should be placed before patching the eye. Few examples. Then Marcus jaw winking ptosis. The principles of the surgery, the correction of the ptosis along with the elimination of the jaw winking. Options include in unilateral levator excision with the unilateral sling. It causes asymmetric lag ophthalmos and lid lag in down gaze. Second option is unilateral levator excision with bilateral sling. It eliminates asymmetric lag ophthalmos. The best is bilateral levator excision with bilateral sling. It gives the most symmetrical results. However, practically it's not possible. Usually parents will not allow to touch the normal eye. Then few complications. The undercorrection most frequent after the congenital ptosis surgery. Just a minute. So it may improve as the edema subsides. Obvious undercorrection needs early correction. Overcorrection more common following surgery of the acquired ptosis, so be careful. Your resection of the LPS should be less as compared with what we do in the congenital ptosis. Then localized disc contour abnormalities may be seen sometimes, and lead crease abnormalities, lag ophthalmos, conjunctival prolapse can occur rarely. And exposure keratitis, there is a lag ophthalmos. I must see the Bell's phenomena preoperatively, and suturing should be proper. Infection granuloma formation may also be seen sometimes, especially with the sealing operations. So the take-home message I would like to say, the congenital ptosis surgery, in spite of all its challenges and reported all postoperative complications, is extremely gratifying if the basic principle of the management are followed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful presentation. May I now request, we can have the questions in the end of the session if we have any. May I now request our next speaker, respected Professor Neelam Pushkar ma'am from Dr. RP Center, Ames. She's a renowned oculoplastic surgeon there. She'll be speaking on surgical correction of entropion, avoid skin scar.
Good morning, everyone. I'll be talking about surgical correction of interventional entropion, how to avoid the skin scar. So we all know the problems we need to address in involutional entropion are, we generally find overriding of preseptal fibers over the pre-tarsal fibers. We know that the retractors are lax in these patients. There is excess skin, the lid is lax, and the tendon is also lax. So we have to evaluate the patient accordingly. So we look for the horizontal lid laxity. We do the pinch test, and if it is more than 6 mm, we know that it is severe. Then we have to look for the orbicularis muscle tone, and for this we do snapback test, and if the lid is not going back to its position with few blinks, then it means that the muscle tone is also absent. Then lateral canthal laxity we have to see. For this, we pull the lower lid medially, and we see the lateral canthal angle, the shift of the angle. If it is more than equal to 4 mm, we know that it is severe. The medial canthal laxity we see by pulling the lid laterally, and we look for the shift of the puncta. If the shift is more than equal to 4 mm, we know that it is severe. So we need to tackle such severe condition also when we operate. Then we have to look for the sagging of the lid, or so-called lid retraction, whether it is there or not. So here we can compare between a young and an old patient. We can see in the uppermost picture, we can see the medial canthal laxity. The shift of the puncta is hardly 1-2 mm in young patient, and in old patient it is almost crossing the mid-corneal line. Then you can see the lateral canthal shift in young patient, hardly 1-2 mm, and in old patient it is reaching almost till the temporal limbus. And the laxity, the overall horizontal laxity also you can compare, it's almost double in the old patient. So along with all this, we have to look for the capsulopalpebral fascia laxity also. We know that it is the extension from the inferior rectus which comes and inserts at the lower border of the tarsal plate. So if that is weak, then we see that the eyelid position rests little higher than the normal, which is at the limbus. So we see that it is little higher than the normal. And if we ask the patient to look up down, we see the excursion, which is normal. Normally it should move 3-4 mm. We see that that is also reduced. Then because the retractors are lax, so what happens is that the retractor, it along with the fornix, it retracts in the orbit. And when we check the inferior fornix, it is deeper than the other side, normal side. And if there is dehiscence of retractors, we see that there is a pinkish orbicularis band which is there in between the white edge of the inferior retractor and the lower border of the tarsal plate. So when we come to the surgery, we know that there are basically two components we need to tackle. One is the vertical strengthening, the other one is the horizontal strengthening. For vertical strengthening, we can do just skin muscle excision, or we can handle the retractors if they are weak. The procedure is known as Jones procedure, or we can combine these two procedures for strengthening the lid vertically. For horizontally, the nowadays a popular technique is lateral tarsal strip. We know, we all know about it. And or we can do just full thickness resection of the lid. We remove the pentagon depending on the amount of horizontal laxity, or Wheeler's procedure is also described. So a little bit about the procedures which are commonly done. Wheeler's procedure is done when there is no to mild horizontal lid laxity. And in this, as shown in the diagram here, we give a full thickness cut in the lid, around 4 to 5 mm from the lid margin. And then we pass the verting sutures and we close the skin muscle layer. But when there is excessive horizontal laxity, then we have to reduce the overall horizontal length of the lid also. For that, we have Kuchert's technique, which is basically like V's, but we take out full thickness pentagon of the lid, as shown in the diagram over here, and then we pass the everting sutures and we close the skin muscle layer. Jones procedure, very useful and popular technique, because we all know that the basic pathology is in the retractors, the inferior retractors are lax. So this procedure gives a good long-term result, especially when you combine this with the horizontal technique. So this is how it is done, that we plicate the inferior retractors. This is the external approach, the skin approach Jones procedure. You can see the three matrix sutures are passed, and then the skin muscle is removed. And on table, we should achieve little overcorrection in involutional entropion cases. Then lateral tarsal strip, I'll show you the video. This is for the horizontal tightening. So this is a video which I'll show. This is a conjunctival root procedure for the correction of involutional entropion to avoid the skin scar. So in this, basically, I'll be showing you the lateral tarsal strip procedure combined with the anterior advancement of inferior retractors after disinserting. This will be by the conjunctival approach. This has got audio in it.
A case of lower eyelid senile entropion. Snapback test is done. Medial and lateral canthal ligament laxity is checked. Pinch test is done. After infiltrating local anesthesia, lateral canthotomy, followed by cantholysis is done. Lid is stretched laterally to assess the amount of lid tightening required and marked. Excise the skin and fashion a strip of tarsus. Make the lid margin surface raw and remove the conjunctiva also. Excess strip is vertically shortened as needed. Lid is averted on a spatula, conjunctiva is undermined and incised at the lower border of the tarsus. Inferior retractors are undermined and separated from the lower border of the tarsus. Using double arm suture, partial thickness bite is taken from the anterior mid surface of the tarsus, then from the retractors, and taken out from the skin side about 3 mm from the lid margin. tighten and ensure mild eversion of the lid margin. Similarly, medial and the lateral sutures are passed. Sutures are tied. You can see mild lid eversion. Now the conjunctiva is sutured. Pinch test is done.
Started again.
After infiltrating local anesthesia.
Can you fast forward this? So basically, after closing the conjunctiva, the tarsal strip was sutured at the inner border of the orbital rim. Leave it, I think.
A case of lower eyelid senile entropion.
So you can see here that the strip is sutured. This should be at the inner border of the orbital rim so that the lid is opposed to the globe.
Lateral canthus sutures passed at the level of the gray line.
This is very important step to align the lateral canthus. Passing the suture through the gray line.
Skin is closed.
Okay, done. Back to the PPT, please. Just 2 more minutes. Yeah, so this is the post-op of the same patient. You can see here. This is of the this another patient with bilateral inferior lower lid entropion. And lower down, you can see the post-op. Right eye was operated first, and then later on, left eye was operated. Left eye is 1 day post-op. So the limitation specific to this technique is that excess skin cannot be removed. Otherwise, in combined technique, you can have rarely eyelid necrosis when you are tackling both the horizontal and the vertical components. Then eyelid retraction can be there if you are doing excessive shortening of the inferior retractors. So for best result, it's very important to know the etiology to tackle the vertical and horizontal component together, and that will give you better long-term results. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for a wonderful demonstration of the surgery through the video. A very self-explanatory and a very nice video. Thank you, ma'am. May I now request our next speaker, Dr. Bhavna Piplani Khurana. She's a postgraduate from MAMSI and presently practicing in Khurana Eye Center as a senior consultant. Pediatric ophthalmologist and oculoplastic surgeon. She'll be speaking on an innovative technique of surgical correction of entropion again.
Good morning, everybody. I'll be speaking on a technique of upper lid entropion. Upper lid entropion, the common etiologies are trachoma, chronic blepharoconjunctivitis, chemical burns, cicatrizing conjunctivitis, topical anti-glaucoma medications, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, herpes zoster ophthalmicus, ocular cicatricial pemphigoid, etc. The considerations that we keep in mind while tackling a case of upper lid entropion are the severity of entropion, thickness of the tarsal plate, presence of anophthalmic socket or artificial eye, planning of a future corneal graft, presence or absence of keratin on the posterior lamella, degree of eyelid retraction, degree of any lag of thalmos, underlying etiology, and presence of dystichiasis. The technique that I've used in a few cases and got good results is combination of anterior lamellar repositioning plus gray line splitting plus tarsal fracture, which can tackle any degree of upper lid entropion with a thickened entropion and even in the presence of dystichiasis. The surgical steps are as follows. After injecting local anesthesia, the upper lid is everted and we make an incision 1 to 2 millimeter deep into the gray line just anterior to the meibomian gland orifices, followed by incision in the skin crease, and we undermine the anterior tarsal surface until the lash roots are visible. At this point, we can also remove any aberrant dystichiatric lashes that can be seen directly under supervision from the root itself. Next, with the blade, we do a full thickness tarsotomy through the anterior tarsal surface along the line of maximum tarsal thickness. After this, we can use 3 to 4 double-armed 6-0 vicryl sutures, pass the needle from the skin above the lash root, then through the tarsal plate such that it comes out through the lower part of the tarsotomy, then through the tarsus above the tarsal incision, and then back to the skin above the lashes around 2 millimeter apart and at the same level as the entry site. We tie the sutures tightly such that the lashes get everted and split in the lid margin opens up. The height of tarsal fixation controls the lid eversion. The lid split that is created is allowed to granulate and does so within less than a week's time. We can excise a small amount of excess skin and muscle created by repositioning. The skin closure is done with 6-0 vicryl sutures. This is one case which got good result with this technique. The above is the pre-op photograph. The below is the post-op photograph within 1 week of surgery. This is also a pre and a post-op photograph. Another case, the above is the pre-op photo. The below is the post-op, next day, post-op day one photograph. This is another post-op photograph. So the advantages that I found with this technique are that the lid contour is well maintained because of the component of the gray line split, because of which the posterior lamella is kept in position and it helps to maintain the contour. There are very less chances of lag of thalmos and lid notching, which are seen more commonly with other tarsal procedures such as tarsal fracture and tarsal rotation procedures. And dystichiasis can be handled directly by removing the aberrant lashes under direct visualization at the time of the surgery itself. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhavna. And I think after tackling entropion, and I think both upper lid and lower lid have been tackled now, let's move on to ectropion. I welcome Dr. Urmil Chawla. Ma'am's a professor at PGIMS Rohtak, and she practices oculoplasty. And her talk is on psychiatrical ectropion. Ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Rajna. Okay, we move on to ectropion. Cicatricial ectropion I'll be covering mainly, remodeling with 5-FU along with the definitive management. Ectropion, as you know, is a commonly encountered eyelid malposition. It is characterized by rotation of lid margin outwards, resulting in its fall away from the globe. It involves the lower lid more commonly than the upper lid. It can be involutional, paralytic, cicatricial, mechanical, and very rarely congenital. But we'll be covering mainly the cicatricial. These are a few cases I have dealt with of cicatricial ectropion. It is usually associated with the shortening of the anterior lamella, the skin and the orbicularis muscle. Etiology is mainly any prior surgical resections of tissue, burns, any actinic damage, autoimmune diseases, or any chronic inflammation. Chemical burns of the eyelids are common, and this may lead to ocular damage. Wound contracture can cause the ectropion of the eyelid, and lower eyelid, as I told you, are more commonly involved. The clinical consequences can be both functional as well as cosmetic, and if untreated, they may lead to keratitis, scarring of the cornea and conjunctiva, globe perforation, and also rarely may lead to blindness. Common indications are generally documented ectropion with chronic eye irritation despite topical lubrication, exposure keratopathy, chronic keratoconjunctivopathy, tearing related to outflow, related to reflex, or chronic dermatitis. Now, coming to the management part, it could be medical as well as the definitive. Medical, initially conservative management, temporary, but can improve symptoms while we wait for the surgery to take place. Lubricating the ocular surface is very important. Horizontal taping of the eyelid, hyaluronic acid filler injections can be done, and scar modulation is the latest. Lubrication and moisture shields are important. Plastic dressings are often superior to cloth patches. Taping the infralateral canthal skin supratemporally provides temporary relief. If the conjunctiva is markedly keratinized, a lubricating ointment should be used prior to the ectropion repair. Corneal epithelial defects and prior herpes simplex infection are a relative contraindication to steroid-containing ointments. Hyaluronic acid filler injections are one alternative. They can be successfully used by they expand the tethered anterior lamella of the skin. This provides an effective alternative to surgical correction of the lid, and the treatment is quick, safe, and easy to learn. Coming to the main part, the scar modulation. More recently, progress has been made in modulating overly aggressive wounds still actively involved in the scarring process by using several injectable drugs. One of them is 5-FU. It is an anti-metabolite that works by irreversibly inhibiting the enzyme thymidylate synthetase, resulting in impaired DNA synthesis. This reduces fibroblast proliferation and inhibits collagen type 1 production, which is a key protein in scar formation. Subcutaneous injections of 5-FU, 50 mg per ml, can be given to patients with periorbital and lid scarring every 4 weeks for a total of up to 6 injections. At each visit, patients are evaluated for redness, swelling, tissue inflammation, telangiectasis, and pigmentary disturbances. Intralesional 5-FU for scar modulation is an off-label use and should be avoided in active chronic infections or immune depression of pregnant lactating women. This is a small video of... It's a very cheap drug available. The vial is of 30 rupees only or 40 rupees. You just take it, inject lignocaine first in the scarred area, followed by 5-FU. We can take it in a 1 ml or an insulin syringe, and just around the scar area, all around the scarred area, you can just give 2-3 injections. And it has really given dramatic results in patients, especially the symptomatic relief. Next day, next visit, the patient will tell you that the stretching effect has reduced. So even after the first treatment, the cicatrix is a little softer and more mobile, sometimes less fixated to underlying tissue and described as less tight by the patients. These improvements may continue over 3 to 5 treatments. Although there can be some temporary swelling and redness for 2 or 3 days, risks are minor. A topical anesthetic cream can be used. These are few cases I'll show you, which have been treated with 5-FU. We can see that the amount of cicatricial ectropion, it also decreases. Mild cases, I have seen that they have shown good results. The fullness of the scarred area that comes and the relief that the patient feels is quite significant. This patient had a notching in the upper lid, which reduced a little after 2 injections of 5-FU. This was another patient. You can see closely that there's a reduction in the amount of the lid touching the globe has increased. This patient was not able to close her eyelid, but after a few injections, 3 or 4 injections, she was able to close her eyelid properly after the injections. This is another patient of medial cicatricial ectropion with the periorbital area, which showed, you can see the scarred area, the amount of improvement we can see there. Another patient, which we treated with the same technique, this is another one. So this is a very good modality nowadays to definitely go ahead with 5-FU injections. And followed, obviously, very advanced cases cannot be treated with it, but they definitely give relief in symptoms as well as the surgical management also becomes easy because the fibrotic part, it becomes softer to deal with. So coming to the surgical management, these are few similar cases of post-traumatic cicatricial ectropion who reported for management, and similar steps of surgery were performed. Patients reported with history of mild pain, redness, and watering. Visual acuity was normal. The lower lid of the involved eye had developed contracture due to the injury. Scarring was present in the lateral third of the lid in 3 and in the medial third of the lid in 1, along with conjunctival dryness. Ocular movements were full and rest was also normal. 3 injections of 5-FU were given at an interval of 4 weeks.
Softening of the tissue was observed and symptomatic relief reported by patient in reduction of the tightening effect was there. However, the complete cosmetic effect we cannot give in advanced cicatricial ectropion, so we need to go for the surgical management. So it often requires lengthening of the anterior lamella by a skin graft. I'll show you a few steps. I have a video, if time permits, I'll show you. Patient was managed by releasing the skin contractures with incisions running along the eyelid margin down to the orbicularis muscle. A subciliary incision is given and the fibrotic tissue is removed after additional dissection. The lower lid is released completely so that it can be freely mobilized. Horizontal dimensions are measured. The vertical dimensions at different places are measured, not only the central and the side. And then if the graft size is appropriate, we can use the retroauricular area, or if it is too large, you can use the supraclavicular area also. So retroauricular measurements are taken. The graft size has to be kept a little few millimeters more than what is required at the host junction. So graft markings are done. Local anesthesia given in the retroauricular area. Skin incision given to raise the graft. Skin undermining and dissection is done. The skin graft is raised. After this, the skin is the graft is thinned of all the subcutaneous tissue so that only dermis and epidermis remain. It is placed over the defect. It is sutured into position with 6-0 silk sutures, completing the graft suturing, and few stab incisions are given over the grafted skin to relieve the hematoma in the first few post-op days. And frost suture is taped to the forehead and a double eye pad is placed over the repair for 48 hours followed by antiseptic dressing. So you put a bolster and you give a compression at the site of the... I think I'll show the video in the end. So this is the post-op result. In the initial first, after 48 hours when you open the bandage, sometimes it is a black ishar which is formed. First time when I had operated, even I had got scared what has gone wrong. But it is the normal appearance. The slowly and slowly this black thing will take the color of the normal skin and it really gives you good results. And obviously you have to take care of the retroauricular area where you have taken the graft. So these are the results. This is a preoperative. After 4 weeks of skin grafting, the skin generally merges. A little bit of cosmetic blemish is there, but it generally merges with the surrounding skin. This was another case with relief of the cicatricial ectropion. This was post-operative 4 days. You can see the amount of stretch, how much it is relieved after the thing. This was a case of medial ectropion, which we had dealt. In this case, because the canaliculus was also involved, we had used the mini Minocca, followed by, we did not need the grafting in this. Simple dissection and suturing was helpful after passing the mini Minocca. So this was the post-operative result. Coming to the complications, ectropion surgery is considered safe and effective. Recurrence does occur occasionally after several years, requiring a repeat surgery. Like any eyelid surgery, there's always a possibility of local post-op bleeding or infection, but these are generally minor. Injury to the cornea may be possible. It is a clinical situation, ectropion, where the lid margin falls away from the globe. Cicatricial is generally secondary to trauma. Factors which include vertical skin shortage, contracture, and horizontal skin laxity, and deficiency of muscle may accompany. And severe cicatricial ectropion creates a marked aesthetic deformity and poses a risk of corneal exposure, and so mandatory is the treatment. It's a real challenge to the ophthalmologist and plastic surgeons. There is often inadequate muscular support for the pre-tarsal lower eyelid. Treatment is centered on release of the cicatricial changes. Full thickness skin grafts are most commonly used to manage such ectropion, and surgical complications I have discussed. So coming to the conclusion, thickness post-auricular skin graft in severe cicatricial ectropion provides good cosmesis and relief from the symptoms and early prevention of exposure keratitis secondary to the ectropion. Do we have time for the video? Or you want to?
Thank you, Dr. Ulmer. That was a wonderful talk, I would say, and amazing results with 5 fluorouracil, which you have shown. Just few questions, if you can answer.
Yes, ma'am, why not?
Are there any changes in the skin color with the use of 5-fluorouracil?
No, ma'am. My very mild, 1 or 2 patients came with very mild itching problem, but there was absolutely no changes in the skin texture. In fact, the patients are very, very happy. They come, when I call them for after 2 weeks, they're extremely happy because that wo jo khichawat and jo stretching effect is there, that is dramatically improved. They feel softening and they feel the effect very nicely. And after 2 or 3 injections, it is really good. And there is no, particularly no side effects have been seen as of now. I've been following them for more than 1 or 2 years. In fact, respected Dr. Khurana sir had started this in our department, and he is my mentor. He just started, but we are just following his steps, and it is really giving us good results. And the surgical management also becomes very easy, because removing the fibrotic tissue after it has got a little softened is very effective.
So what cases you feel that this will work alone? Where you
very, very mild ectropion.
Surgery can be avoided.
Very, very mild ectropion. Very, very, like I showed you two cases in which one the lid could be closed, and in which another one there was a very mild. I have treated 2-3 cases of very mild ectropion with only 5FU. The lid which was not touching the globe, it just gets a little softened and it touches the globe, and mainly the symptoms of watering and other problems are relieved, and the patient does not feel the need. The cosmetic problem is not that much that he wants a surgical treatment.
I think I must congratulate you for the wonderful results you have shown.
Thank you,
Dr. Amil.
Maximum literature I have seen, 6 injections have been given. In one sitting, we are giving around 1 to 2 ml. Okay, and we are repeating after 4 weeks, but right now I'm also doing a thesis on the same topic, and we are comparing 5FU alone with 5FU plus steroid. And that is also a good thing, and we are repeating it after 2 weeks. So maximum 4 injections we are planning to do. This was when I was repeating. I'm telling you, right now I'm doing a thesis on this, in which we have also trying to repeat it after 2 weeks. Yeah, no, the ampule is quite big. It is 5 ml. We are just taking 1 ml out of it, 1 to 2 ml maximum. Depending also on the scarred area. Sometimes the scar is very small, so you need just 1 ml. But sometimes it is a big scar. Then you can inject 1 to 2 ml. That is all around the scarred area can be covered. No. Okay. No, I have no experience for this. Sorry. Thank you so much.
Now I would like to invite Dr. Rachna Meel.
I would like to ask you one thing. Where is the injection given exactly? Is it
in the fibrotic area?
Or into the?
Into the fibrotic area and
right into the lesion,
right
into the scar.
Fibrotic scarred area.
Okay, thank
right
you.
Thank you.
So Dr. Rachna Meel, she is a very dynamic oculoplasty surgeon we have at RP Center AIIMS. And she is doing a lot of oncology also. She'll be talking about lid retraction.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for those kind words. Good morning, everyone. And I think my topic that I have to cover for today is eyelid retraction, managing the staring eye. And I have no financial interest to disclose. To begin the talk, you must have observed that eyelid retraction is not so frequently discussed in various conferences or oculoplastic talks when we go as ptosis. The reason being it's less commonly seen, and therefore you have to deal with it less commonly. Also, I feel as an oculoplastic surgeon, it is less defined. The surgery for lid retraction is less defined in terms of the surgical landmarks and the amounts that you have to do as compared to a ptosis surgery that almost every one of us does. And outcomes, again, are much less predictable as compared for a ptosis surgery. So that's why probably it's not that much discussed, and not many of us are very, willing to do this surgery and correction of this problem. So let me just refresh the definition of upper eyelid retraction, which is what I'm going to be covering. We know that normally the upper eyelid is positioned about 2 millimeters from the upper limbus. So it covers around 2 millimeters of the normal upper cornea. And therefore, an eyelid which is above this position is said to have upper eyelid retraction. So normally you may see a scleral show like shown in this case, but even this eye has an eyelid retraction. And so you may not always find a scleral show, but you still may have lid retraction. So you have to remember that mild lid retraction cases may not present to you with scleral show. Coming on to causes, thyroid eye disease remains the most common cause for eyelid retraction, which may present bilaterally or even sometimes unilaterally. The other cause that we come across frequently is the congenital eyelid retraction, which is essentially a stationary problem identified early after birth, and the eyelid position remains more or less stationary throughout the growth. Post-surgically also, you could see eyelid retraction, like in this case. This could be after overcorrection of ptosis. It could also be seen after squint surgery. So if someone has done a superior rectus recession, like was done for correction of hypertropia in this case, the right eye developed a upper eyelid retraction. We saw a case where following orbitotomy and removal of a mass lesion from the superior orbit, the patient developed an upper eyelid retraction in the left eye. Another common cause which may be missed if you've not seen the patient carefully or if you've not taken the history. Can you make out? Yes, facial nerve palsy. It could also present with a lid retraction. And what you have to look for is this, the angle that's not going back. Another very interesting cause of lid retraction, pseudo-retraction. So if you see this picture carefully, what you have to note is the other eyelid, and you can see that the other eyelid is ptotic, and when you lift the ptotic eyelid, the retracted eyelid becomes normal. So essentially, you see pseudo-retraction due to the Herring's law, where the ptotic eyelid is deriving the other eyelid, and the increased innervation to the normal eyelid results into a retraction. So what you need to do is the ptosis correction. Although proptosis could also result in mechanical eyelid retraction, but mostly it is seen in the lower eyelid, not in the upper eyelid, but it's an important entity to remember, and therefore a Napsiger's test is an important test that you must do in cases where you're not sure if it is lid retraction or proptosis. Other than that, any kind of lamellar shortening, whether posterior or anterior, could also present with eyelid retraction. However, in these cases, you would have eyelid margin abnormalities. So if it is a posterior lamellar shortening, it may be associated with entropion. If it's an anterior lamellar shortening, again, which could be because of thermal burns, or in some cases because of microblepharon, which is a congenital problem, you may also have associated ectropion in these cases. This is another child with microblepharon where there's an anterior lamellar shortening, and as you may notice that apart from the lid retraction, the child is also showing ectropion in the upper eyelid. Coming on to management, now not all cases can be managed surgically, so you need to know where you need to observe and where you need to go in for surgery. So observation is what you must do. If it's a thyroid eye disease, which is active, so you would not like to do surgery in this case. Also, if the thyroid function tests are deranged, it's not the time to intervene. A facial nerve palsy, recent onset, you wait at least for 6 months. And here, temporarily, you could do injections with hyaluronic acid, triamcinolone has been described, and also Botox. You could do a temporary tarsography. Coming on to surgical management, of course, it depends on the cause. So if it's a pseudo-retraction, you have to correct the ptosis. If it's a lamellar shortening, you would do grafting. And then, of course, there is levator surgery. So this was the case with microblepharon, and we did a skin grafting, and it did correct the lag of thalamus and the lid retraction in this child. Now, levator surgery for lid retraction is essentially a retractor weakening procedure or a retractor lengthening procedure. We have to weaken the retractor, and there are several surgeries that have been described, like Z-myotomy, tenotomy, retractor recession, and recession with spacer. However, all of these have the same problem. They are unpredictable. The corrections of these surgeries are unpredictable. It's difficult to measure the amount that you have lengthened, especially when you're doing it from the conjunctival side. And also, I believe, a very important shortcoming is the dependence on the lid traction sutures, which are very essential for a successful outcome of surgery. So the patient needs to put the eyelid on traction for at least 6 weeks after surgery. So coming on to what surgery would you do for what retraction? So again, retraction is graded just like ptosis. It's based on MRD1, and the amount is MRD1 of the affected eye minus MRD1 of the normal eye. So this is a mild retraction, which is less than 2 millimeters, moderate would be 2 to 4 millimeters, and severe would be more than 4 millimeters. So what would you want to do for a mild eyelid retraction? Essentially, we could do a tenotomy. What is a tenotomy? We do a full thickness incision in the molars and the aponeurosis of the LPS, and then we put the lid on traction. That is all we do in tenotomy. And this is how the results were in this patient after 6 weeks. For a moderate eyelid retraction, tenotomy is not sufficient. What you need to do is a levator recession. And what are you doing in levator recession? Essentially, we are cutting off all the insertions of the LPS. We cut it off the sclera, we cut the horns, and we dissect off the conjunctiva, and we recess. We recess the levator aponeurosis using hangback sutures. And this is, so the hangback sutures which pass through the sclera and out onto the skin. You could do it through anterior approach or a posterior approach, but the big question is how much recession? How much do you want to recess for correcting a given amount of retraction? So what you need to remember is, unlike ptosis where you measure the amount that you have resected, it's not the same for recession. How you judge is by the lid position. So intraoperative lid position. So the lid position should be lower than the normal position by an amount that is equal to the amount of retraction. So your immediate post-op position should be lower by an amount equal to the amount that you want to correct, or double from the original position. And then of course you put this frozen suture and put the lid on a downward traction. What about severe eyelid retraction? In severe eyelid retraction, recession alone does not work. So what you need is a spacer between the levator and the sclera. Now, several spacers have been used and reported. These include silicon, vicryl mesh, PTFE, sclera, temporalis fascia, acellular dermis, cartilage, and so on. But yet, they're not very popular in upper eyelid. Reason being, the lid is rubbing onto the cornea, and so many of these spacers have an inherent problem of causing corneal problems. So they are more popular for the lower lid. So recently, we did report use of MMG, mucous membrane graft, as a spacer for severe eyelid retraction. And it was Professor Neelam Pushkar's idea. And we did it in 4 patients and found predictable results, although our follow-ups were short of around 3 to 4 months. And this is a short video that I would want to show you, since I think we have time, sorry. Yeah, so this is the conjunctival root. After infiltrating, we evert the lid on demise. And this is the incision that we make through the conjunctiva at the upper edge of the tarsus. And after incising the conjunctiva, so this is a little longer, I'll just try to make it a little short. You identify the next layer, which is the molars, which is attached on the upper edge of tarsus. So we pick it up, incise, and give a full thickness incision through the length of the lid. And once that is done, you see the tarsus is now lifted off, and the next layer is aponeurosis, which is inserting over the anterior surface of tarsus. We now incise this layer of levator aponeurosis, again full thickness. So the steps are similar as you would do for a conjunctival root LPS resection. And after having done that, we identify the orbicularis, and we separate the fibers of orbicularis, pass sutures through the levator aponeurosis and the conjunctiva, and identify the septum as you would do for an anterior approach procedure. And once that is done, you identify the fat, preaponeurotic fat, incise the septa to release the fat, dissect it off to identify the LPS muscle. Then you cut the horns on both the sides. And this is a pre-harvested mucous membrane graft, the thickness of which was twice the amount of retraction that we wanted to correct. So it was 5, so we took a 10 millimeter wide MMG from the buccal mucosa. And this was sutured at one end to the levator, and the other end was sutured to the tarsus, and those sutures were then taken out through the eyelid margin, which was marked before we started the surgery. Yeah, so this is the bite through the tarsus. So they are horizontal matrix sutures again, through the tarsus, through this edge of the mucous membrane graft, and out through the eyelid margin, which was pre-marked. So three such sutures are passed, and that's about it. And you put the eyelid on traction for around 6 weeks. This was the outcome of the patient at the end of 4 weeks, and I would like to point out that in this case, the patient did tend to have undercorrection. So essentially, when at the end of 4 weeks or 6 weeks, when you take off the traction sutures, the eyelid should still be ptotic and not in a normal position, which it is going to rise after you take off the traction suture. So there are other surgeries that have been described, which include full thickness eyelid transection, and also recently just a transconjunctival lateral levator aponeurectomy was described. And surprisingly, in these patients, traction sutures were not used postoperatively. However, they have reported good results with these surgeries. I would like to reiterate the problem with retraction surgeries, which includes inherent unpredictability, patient compliance factors, which depend on flow suture application, and spacer-related issues. So to conclude, identify the cause, grade the retraction, choose appropriate surgery, ensure patient compliance with eyelid traction, and counsel patient about the unpredictable results. Thank you. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Yeah. Dr. Rachna, for a wonderful talk. Any questions? Okay, unfortunately, yes.
Is there any specific reason why you approach through the conjunctival side rather than skin?
Excuse me, yes. Could you repeat the question?
Is there any specific reason why you approach through the transconjunctival rather than skin?
Yes. So, essentially, conjunctival, we avoid the skin scar, of course. And secondly, I feel it is a faster surgery in terms of identification of the structures. And as it, I mean, except for the scar, I don't think there is, you could do it through an anterior approach as well. I think it's just the surgeon's preference, so.
If you take the anterior approach, you will be cutting the full thickness lid, which as such is not required in these patients. So why to take the skin approach? So best that way is to, because we are handling everything inside, so best would be to take a conjunctival approach. But yes, it can be done through the skin approach also with some risk of necrosis. Because we are, after all, cutting the full thickness lid, because we have to disinsert everything. The conjunctiva, yes, you can leave, because here we are putting the spacer between the LPS, Muller's complex, and the tarsus. So conjunctiva cutting you can avoid if you are taking the skin approach. Yes. That is not required.
So what's your experience on like a sclera CS spacer in your institute?
Sclera as a spacer I never liked, because I have seen people using sclera, and plus the literature, if you see, there is a lot of fibrosis with sclera. It is a thick material that will lead to a bulky lid. So from very beginning, I've been using this only as a spacer, the mucosa, the lip mucosa as a spacer, because I think that is more suitable for the upper lid.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rachna. Unfortunately, our last speaker who was to speak on lag of thalamus could not make it due to some health issues. So this brings us to the end of this instruction course, the oculoplasty tutorial step-by-step approach. I hope it has been helpful to all of you. I once again thank Dr. Panova for her keynote address on eyelid cancer, wonderful. And I also thank all my co-instructors, Dr. Khurana sir, Dr. Neelam Pushkar ma'am, Dr. Rachna Amil ma'am, Dr. Bhavna, for this presentation. And we have completed our instruction course well on time. So if any questions, or we go to the next. Yeah, I can show you that. That's the video of grafting. Can you please show me the thing? Mary, Mali, talk. हाँ जी, यस यही यही वाला ऊपर वाला दबा दीजिए एक बार, यस इसको ही ऑन कर दीजिए, हाँ जी. सो दिस वाज अ पेशेंट ऑफ सिकैट्रिशियल एक्ट्रोपियन, अ बिग स्कार. डू यू हैव अ पॉइंटर और समथिंग? सो देयर इज अ बिग सिकैट्रिशियल स्कार आफ्टर पासिंग द स्टे सूचर्स. These three stay sutures, the spatula is applied, and now the release of the fibrotic tissue. The subciliary incision is being given, and it should involve the scarred area and a little bit of the periorbital surrounding area. It has to be full thickness unless and until you remove all the fibrotic tissue properly. It is bound to recur. The stretching effect is bound to recur. So after removing, just remove all the fibrotic tissue. Put a little volume to it. So this is the fibrotic tissue that is being removed, the scarred part. And you do a surrounding area undermining properly so that you have good tissue. This was the scarred skin also, which was removed, because after removing the tissue, we had this much space that we could get a graft of a good size. So we remove this scarred skin area also. Little editing is more needed, in fact. All surrounding area, wherever you feel the scarred area, you just remove it properly. So now comes the measurement part. You measure it vertically as well as horizontally at the center as well as the periphery also, so that you have good estimation of the graft that you need. Now coming to the retroauricular area, always the marking first and then the anesthesia. So you mark the area, and as I told you, the graft size should be a little bigger, to 1 to 2 millimeters bigger than the what is required. So after marking the retroauricular area, you local anesthesia is given and you go ahead with the skin incision. You can use your radio frequency cautery also for all these purposes, but this was when I was using this. So you pick up this skin graft from this area. Very important step is, on a hard surface you evert it, and then you clean the entire fat or the subcutaneous tissue that is there. You need to have a very thin graft containing only the dermis and the epidermis. So just scrape off this subcutaneous tissue and the fat which is present there. You can scrape it out with the blade, surgical blade, and you have a thin graft. You can now take this graft to the site of where you have the bed where you have to place the graft. So it's a little vertically, you can see it's a little bigger than the size which we need, and start it from the apex, the first suture, 6-0 silk. You start it one side from the apex. After tying all the sutures, four sutures are left big enough They act as stay sutures. Obviously, you have to take care of the retroauricular area also. Suture the retroauricular area properly. And this was after the suturing, we give stab incisions so that any hematoma, this is very important. Otherwise, next day you may get a very swollen hematoma may be formed. So always give stab incisions for a little ooze that may occur. And the bigger sutures which we had left, we wrap them around this bolster. And this is how we end the surgery. And post-op results I had shown you before. Thank you, everybody. This brings us to the end of the instruction course, and the next team would come and start with the next one. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.